speed of light, nothing can interfere with the message. So that's why every possible idea that we have expressed in the material world is being coded in digital terms and being put in fiber optics and radio waves. So as we become an information-driven species, the boundaries of national politics and territorial politics are no longer there. So in our view at Democracy Earth, our domain name is democracy.earth, we try to challenge a little bit the idea of the nation state. It has been quite a triumph for humanity after so many years of wars and the Westphalian treaties of the 17th century until this day have kind of gave us a world order that keeps the world in peace every now and then until everything blows up again. But the rise of these networks that are global by definition will start building alternatives to the nation state itself. And we're seeing already the divorce between money and state, which is a pretty big deal. That's a huge deal. Like the dollar going down, Bitcoin going up is enormous. There's like, and I as an Argentine, I think to us Argentines this is like a no-brainer because we have been distrusting our own currency since I was born, since I have a living memory. It's in Argentina, it's never trust the money of your government. And now this has gone up a notch with the US dollar, and especially after the events of the last decade. I think when it's interesting, we're going to see a lot of these pilots. We're actually, for the Venezuelan the election at Democracy Earth, we're going to do a lot of noise. We're going to implement a pilot related to that. Thinking long term, the real challenge that blockchains and these crypto networks pose for anyone building on top of them is how we can build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. And that new model will be global, will be transnational, will be censorship resistant, digital. And at the end, it's about personal sovereignty, like this new notion of sovereignty that goes down to the individual level. There's a great book, probably you heard about it, probably not, but it's Peter Thiel's favorite book. If you go to Peter Thiel's house, you will find a whole shelf with hundreds of copies of this same book. And since he's the most powerful human, because he endorsed Trump and what happened there, Facebook, that's what happened. The Sovereign Individual, which is a book written by two British economists. It's a book from 1997, and it's very prophetic when you read it right now because it's the first book that really understands information theory, really understands how this information theory permeates economics, and there are many passages of the book describing what's going to happen when humans are able to transact with each other in a completely encrypted way, and there's nothing a government can do to look into that. And these new structures of creating and transacting value are happening in front of our eyes right now. And they are really challenging to the very concept of the nation state. Something that the sovereign individual says is that the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989 was not just an isolated event that led to the end of communism. It's just the first episode of many episodes to happen that have to do with the end of the nation state itself. And then you can put there probably the Twin Towers and other like big symbolic events that drove human attention to a single focus point, where we all change our perception of the world itself. I think this is part of a greater arc of the historical narrative that we're living in, and the episode related to cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin and Ethereum and all these networks is any relevant technology in this space, by definition, has to be a geopolitical disruption, because this space is about changing the institutional layer of reality. It's not no longer about changing culture or changing communications or connecting humans. It's about something way more interesting than that. That is changing the very foundations of how we create human institutions and who gets to create them and who gets to benefit from them. And it's democratizing many of the properties related to that. So it's a big disruption. Maybe that's my
idea. It's a huge endeavor,
yeah.
Obviously. And yeah, what are your thoughts, if I may? I'm Jean from Montreal. About the transition period, inevitably, it cannot happen overnight. It will take probably decades. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on
We are more into that transition that we know, and at the same time, it's still all very new. When I gave this talk in Berlin in a crypto conference led by Blockstack, a great event. And the surprising thing for many in the room was that, holy shit, we've been discussing about what would happen when a nation state starts using guns and weapons and imprisoning miners. It already happened in Venezuela, and that's a political narrative ongoing right now. We're in that future, in that theoretical discussion is no longer theoretical. What happened last year when Bitcoin reached 20,000, it was a theoretical thing. Also, I remember Bitcoin being $1, $2, and what would happen? Yeah, Bitcoin's gonna be worth one day $1 million, and you had Bitcoin back then and say, okay, right. And now the normalization around Bitcoin, one Bitcoin, $1 million. It's not that strange, like it's not that far-fetched. If it did like 20,000% or 2,000% last year, or that's every year, 1,000%, has been doing like 1,000% on a yearly basis for the past 10 years, except with the period of 14, 15, it will get weirder, it will get more strange. It feels like we are the monkeys in Space Odyssey 2001, and the monolith, the blockchain is the monolith, and we are like all trying to understand proof of work, proof of stake, and the thing keeps growing and growing, and we cannot really properly understand if Satoshi Nakamoto came from the future or not. But it's interesting to see how the political class is trying to cope with. I'm a member of the World Economic Forum, and last year I went to Dubai to the, I'm in the Council of Natural Resource Security, which is natural resources and protecting the environment. The only thing we talked about was the consumption of energy related to blockchains. We haven't talked about anything else. For a brief moment, we talked about synthetic meat. The other 2 days, we talked about blockchain and energy and what's going on with this. And in Davos, blockchain this, blockchain that, the World Economic Forum is the establishment, so they're really scared to say Bitcoin. Like the Bitcoin word, it's a scary word, but the real deal is Bitcoin. I tend to be a bit of a maximalist. The concern is definitely there. Now, we're seeing a jurisdictional competition between governments, Japan being super friendly, and Australia, and South Korea. Every time Kim sent a rocket over Japan, the price of Bitcoin went up. Every time. Because South Koreans feared that they were going to have a war, and if they need to escape their country super fast, they put their assets on the blockchain. And that's the way I migrated to the US. I put all of my assets on the blockchain. I came with this country with $0, theoretically. I still have very few dollars. But that's the kind of events. On 2016, again, the events that drove the price of Bitcoin, you can also connect them with India banning cash. Cash was banned in India in late 2016. That also led to every time you see that the price of Bitcoin in a certain country is slightly higher than in the rest of the countries, you go and inspect what's going on in the news in that country, and you will find that, again, Bitcoin works as a very interesting compass to understand the geopolitical nature of the world and how because citizens now have this tool, have this technology, where they can, with a few clicks, encrypt themselves and, you know, entangle their financial self with the blockchain. Now, the encryption itself is a very interesting thing. Encryption is what won the Second World War. It was not the atomic bomb. The atomic bomb was propaganda and instilling fear. And, you know, the thing about the atomic bomb is that you want to show it, and you want to, you know, hey, look at us, we have the bomb, we can bomb everyone, and it's a scary thing. You want to, yeah, it's Freudian. Whereas the computer was actually a secret of state. You know, having computers was not politicized. Like, it was done in the, you know, research in the academia. It was a state secret. It was kept as a secret until the 70s. And then the 70s, industrialization, personal computing, you know, put the technology in people's hands. And it was a secret because the ability to decrypt enemy messages, it's an advantage of intelligence that is very strategical to any nation state that is thinking strategically about, you know, their strength in the world. And since encryption has been included in the US munitions list after the Second World War, there was even a period where you could not export. The famous case in 1992 when someone was caught in an airport with a diskette, a floppy disk having the software for PGP, and PGP was forbidden to be exported from the US, so you could not cross the borders of the US with the software code of PGP because it was considered a weapon. So from the perspective of encryption as a weapon, it's like a Second Amendment right. You know, it's the right to bear arms, the right to bear encryption, because it's really the only realistic guarantee that you have as a citizen to protect yourself from the abuses of the state. More realistic than having an AK for, I don't know nothing about guns. I hate guns. But apparently, I've heard that in this country they like guns a lot. And, you know, if you really like guns, a gun that is intrinsically defensive, like encryption, not, you know, for the purpose of damaging others, is the best guarantee against a state that at the end of the day has nuclear bombs. Like, what you want to do with an AK versus, you know, Dr. Strangelove. But so encryption is a very very interesting new political reality. And it really boils down to empowering the individuals, the citizens, the people themselves. And I think, you know, in Argentina, I remember very well when Bitcoin was starting up back in 2011, 2012. It is still a thing of the geeks and the nerds. Now it has become probably more mainstream because of the high value and people get obsessed with money. Money is a big, you know, very big on influencing behavior. But, you know, fast forward to right now, actually in Argentina, some of the most interesting crypto projects worldwide are being developed there. There's this company called Zeppelin. They have audited over $1.5 billion in smart contracts last year alone. They are the number one guys you go to audit any smart contract running on the Ethereum platform. It's an Argentine company. There's this other company called Decentraland. They're doing a VR world where you can buy pieces of land using their own token. Their token yesterday did over 1,000% in the last, like, if you account the last 6 months of the token, did over 1,000% in performance, measured, valued in Bitcoin, not even valued in dollars. They are, you know, like in the forefront of real estate and crypto when you look at what Decentraland is doing. And this is like a new way, like the engineers that have seen the financial crisis of Argentina, and at the same time have a global mind and are building these technologies. And there, you know, I live in New York now, and I engage with the investor community there, and you know, I know that these projects are very, very much in like the hot projects right now. So it's interesting to see that these technologies are also not that dependent on Silicon Valley. not that dependent on like the territorial nature of like this place that has all the resources, all the investors, all the lawyers, all the accountants, and all the